First of all, I'm not an agile expert at all, but I've been doing some stuff which has got kind of an agile feel to it, and I've been doing some work many, many years ago, which has got some characteristics in common. So rather than stand here, because I know there's people here that don't know an awful lot about it, and tell you stuff you already know, what I'm going to do is throw up a couple of ideas that have emerged recently, which may chime with some of the agile challenges. Second thing I want to say is that when Sean told me that the first keynote speaker was going to be a bunch of children, I wasn't absolutely sure if she was being entirely honest with me. I know it's a hard act to follow, because usually keynote speakers are very sort of august people. They look at this as, you bloody well concentrate, and this is what I'm going to do, you know what it is, and then they try to get them off as quickly as possible. So, I'm probably not going to be like that. Well, you'll figure that out, because I thought we were raccoon in the title. Okay, so I'm going to have to do a few topics to kind of highlight the two areas of principal interest for this. And it's going to be a challenge for my visualization expert here. So, systems analysis. I'm not going to go into this deeply, but obviously it's something that you do when you're trying to understand a problem. You understand the perimeter of it, what's inside your problem, what's outside of the problem. Okay, so we do that. The reason I've got this kind of graphic up for me right now is that what I've been doing is information operations for the government against nasty people, because if we can persuade them not to do something or to turn up at the wrong place, then we don't get a war. So I think it's a pretty good thing to do. This is the kind of, this is a very simple representation of graphic, but obviously if you expand this out, you can end up with what we call social network analysis, where you understand hubs, people who are highly, highly connected. And it's not just the stuff that we deal with, so it's not just the people, but the things as well. So these diagrams can end up being a mixture of people, relationships, stuff, across time. It gets really tangled really quite quickly. And then when I talk about white-hat intelligence in a few minutes, you'll see why we need to. It's a challenge to represent it, and we have to deal with issues of uncertainty and complexity. So, that's the really basic diagram. Many years ago, when I was at university, we looked at soft systems methodology. You'll be familiar with that. That's one kind of systems analysis where you're looking at messy, fuzzy systems, perhaps things aren't very well defined. Then you have deterministic systems as well, where actually, if you put something in at one end, you know exactly what's going to go on the other. There's just a lot of computation between. You know, the relatively stable systems. The complex systems analysis, particularly the hybrid stuff, where you get mixtures of humans and people across time, that's of the greatest interest to me. Of course, with systems of systems, people have for years been doing stuff like failure modes analysis. We try to understand how things could go wrong, and what you do in sort of building safety and so forth. So that's kind of like a massively quick skip through my take on bits of systems analysis. This is probably more the kind of thing that you will be dealing with on a daily basis or in future. And this has kind of a project management feel to it. What do you need to do? Resources, time, and your access to the proper external drivers. And by that I mean people that provide requirements and real constraints and so forth. So that's how you figure out, you know, what is the element possible. So, now this chap here, have you heard of W. Ross Ashby before? I wouldn't be surprised if someone has. Yeah, brilliant. Okay. This guy's an absolute genius. In 1958 he wrote a great paper on cybernetics, which we probably wouldn't call cybernetics now, it's a bit of an old-fashioned name. But he worked on, he came up with the law of requisite variety. It's not really a law. What this asserts, this is a bigger screen than I'm used to. So this thing over here is trying to control this thing. The blue thing has got a degree of variety to it, or complexity. What he asserts in the law of requisite variety is that if this thing is attempting to control this thing, the variety of the first system has to be of the same order as the thing it's controlling. Now, it sounds a bit abstract, but actually there are lots and lots of real-life examples of where this has failed. For example, if this is a set of rules for a bunch of middle managers, and this is the NHS, and these people over here say, okay, we're going to have waiting times which are less than, you know, an hour, and we're going to have so many patients, and a gap between seeing the GP and being referred of so many weeks and so forth. These are fairly simple simple and quite crisp rules. But the problem with the rules is that they don't match the problem. The variety in the rules is much, much less than the complex thing you're trying to control. So why is this relevant? Because you're dealing with complex stuff, and stuff that's not well defined. So if you think about failure modes, you may want to think about how you plan to have more variety than the thing you're trying to control. Now, you can't just make yourself more and more complex and keep adding rules in the hope that eventually V1 will be greater than V2. What you can do instead is try to reduce the complexity of V2. Now, there's an example of that. It's not particularly pleasant, but in conventional war fighting, what you do is you reduce V2, which is your adversary, to a pile of rubble. So their entropy goes up and their complexity goes down. And actually, V1 is then greater than V2. I don't like that. But I think that the law of requisite variety has got a lot to bring us when we look at how to solve problems. Right. So, complexity. And I think complexity is probably one of the most misused words. What I want to do quickly now, again, is to look at the relationship between connectivity and complexity. So, if we... Because it's not a linear relationship, and I know the two words are used almost synonymously. So, the amount of connectivity, if we assume, for example, that the people here, some people got partners and people haven't got partners, and you wanted to work out what sort of the connection diagram was within the room, you could identify, first of all, who are the people that don't have partners? When you stick your hands up, it's not a dating agency. That would be a whole bunch of people which sort of put to one side and say, okay, if you put them to the side, then the second batch of people you deal with have got some connectivity. Mostly, they will have one partner. So then if you want to draw a whole system from that, the answer, I do say mostly. Stories I can tell. If you want to draw a connectivity map for the whole thing, so like I get a massive piece of paper and I'd put it over you and I'd press down so I had the kind of bumps, one bump for each person, I could draw them for them, then for them, then for them, bring your partners as well, just so they don't feel left out. Then I'd end up with quite a complex map of relationships. If everybody here was single, it wouldn't be complex. And that's a Kolmogorov complexity. Kolmogorov complexity is the degree of complexity. You measure it by figuring out basically how difficult it is to express. If you can say they're all single, that's not complex. If about half of you are non-single, that gets really quite difficult to express because there are lots of arrows and stuff like this, and sometimes the arrows will change. If everybody here has got one partner, that's no more complex than if you haven't got one. You can say it's just as quickly, so the Kolmogorov complexity is actually quite low, so you end up with this weird Gaussian function. We'll come back to that again. It's the middle area where you end up with having to describe the connectivity. It takes longer. This Kolmogorov complexity is used a lot, I think, when you're writing computer programs. You're trying to figure out the complexity of a subroutine, for example. What's the shortest way you can express what it does? So, I'm not going to go too deeply into this, but actually, having done the singles doubles thing, this shows roughly the same thing. So, if there's no connectivity between coffee and the cream, then it's really simple to say. Cream's up there, coffee's down there. It's very simple. This is a tangled one. This is where some people are single, some people are. I've got partners or multiple partners. Over here, if you can read that, low complexity. The entropy is high. It's a real mess. You can't easily say what's what, but because there's no order, actually, the complexity of the system is low again. So what we've got instead of a linear relationship between connectivity and complexity, we have something which is actually Gaussian. So, This brings me very, very neatly on to the next thing. Right, what's MIB stand for? It's really obvious. More is better. And Goldilocks function. So, here's a basic relationship. Everyone's going to guess the two answers. When you're starting out, and you're down here, and you're looking up this curve, you know. It's so simple. Actually, it may not quite be like that. So let me show you a different graph with different axes, but this is our Gaussian. Most things in nature are Gaussians, or kind of Gaussian-ish, sometimes a bit skewed or wibbled, but there's no mid functions in nature. Here, we've got how good you are at stuff versus how stressed you are. This is me in my first year at university. I didn't really do that. Finals. Civil service. Now, if I were to have a go at some terrorists, what do? I don't want to be very good at stuff, do I? So there's two places I can operate. I can operate back here, when they're really laid back, or you can push them right to the other end, when they can't function properly. So they're not effective. I don't want to keep them here. Actually, that's where they're trying to keep us. So, the thing about this, there's a similarity between these two. When you're just starting off, and you're in the city centre and you've still got tenor, that thing there looks pretty much like this bit, doesn't it? It's only later on, when you're running out of money, you smell a sick, nobody likes you, you realise that you're down here. Okay, so this is one of the bits of insight. I know I've got here really quickly, and it's really good of you to look at me and laugh when you've only had one cup of coffee. It's early in the day, and this is actually quite a difficult thing to get your head around. But you may be able to translate this and see it in different ways during your professional life. You'll see things and say, that's a Goldilocks function. It's not a MIB. A lot of stuff looks at MIBs when it looks like a MIB when it starts off. So, believe it or not, this picture came up when I Googled the word diversity. Now, there has to be a freaking caption for this, doesn't there? Why are you wearing black? Wear emo cats. It does nothing for my complexion. Go away, we don't like you. So maybe that's what's there. I honestly can't say. My wife is really, and her kids are really, really keen on Star Wars, and I don't remember that particular scene. So, now, diversity has got a lot of different meanings to different people. In terms of solving complex problems, it's an absolute gift. You've got to have diversity. It really, really helps for all of these reasons. These reasons are not entirely distinct. There's a degree of overlap between some of them. However, cast your eyes down. Increases variety. Well, that's helpful. Give a whole bunch of different people looking at a complex problem and probably stand a better chance of being able to regulate it. Nash's law. Introduces disruption. Nice disruption, not just recognition. Encourages minority reporting. Do people still use that phrase? There was a Tom Cruise film called Minority Report, I think. Minority reporting is when you allow one or two people who are in the minority to say, hang on a minute, that's wrong. Now, in UK cabinet politics, we don't have minority reporting. So if one or two people say no to some things, well, they're basically unvoted. So we go with yes. I think in American equivalent to cabinet politics, minority reporting is formally registered. So if someone says, everyone else says yes, but I say no, then that stays on record and that prevents the thing just going forward, so you can't just be simply unvoted, which is interesting. So that's another thing related to having variety or breadth diversity in your kind of toolkit. Is it challenges repetition? Yeah. Offers new perspectives. These are all no-brainers. Suggests new ways of working. And I apologize for this, but when I was writing this, I couldn't find on Google a picture of conveyor belt that adequately expressed two different sorts of work. One of them is what I've called sticking the eyes on teddy bears, which is what stioptism stands for, rolls off the tongue. And then the other kind of work is the work that we do as a community. When I talk about, later on, measuring stuff that's easy to measure, but most managers, you know, you get in, say, right, you got in this time, you didn't this time, and there's a mid-function, there's a relationship between when you get in and when you leave, the amount of time you're there, and how productive you are. Because the longer you're there, the more eyes you've stuck on teddy bears. But at the end of a really long day, there's a massive pile of seeing teddy bears and a really small pile of blind teddy bears. However, if we don't do that kind of work, then actually, you don't want to be measuring the simple things, you want to measure things which are actually more complex. So, diversity supports empathy as well. Why is that important? Obviously, innovation, experimentation as well, supports evolution. Evolution means survival. So, next. The other thing I wanted to bring to your attention that you can reflect on today and thereafter, by all means contact me if you don't get it, if it doesn't sort of get traction right now, is the relationship between naturalistic decision-making, recognition time decision-making, and the agile way of working. So they have some important stuff in common here. Have a look at this if you get a chance on why Gary Klein et al, they were the people that looked at this way of working, which actually shows that human beings don't do super rational decision making, they don't do optimum stuff where they make the most utilitarian decisions. Actually, most of the decisions we make are based on the kind of emotional, we don't have quite enough time to look at all the possible options and make a completely rational sort of arithmetic choice about which is the best thing to go for. And there's good examples of this as well, like the secretary problem, where you have a whole bunch of people coming in, and at some point you've got to say, right, that person will do as the secretary. The trouble is, if you pick someone, it's possible the next person will be even better. But you don't know. But then if you wait until you see everybody in the world, then everyone's died of old age. So it's a bounded rationality problem. So here we have our first chime with the agile thing, not the proven optimum. So RPDM is a system whereby I make a decision because I've got finite time, finite resources, that thing will do. That's actually determined by the product. Kind of. There's a relationship with it there. You don't know. It's definitely the only MVP. It may not be actually the best MVP, but the most efficient, but it'll do. And this thing about it'll do is really, really key. So the viability there is progress. That means you can move on onto your next stage, or beta phase, or whatever. So very briefly, many years ago, someone said to me, we want to set up a small team of about 15 people to find IEDs in Afghanistan, roadside IEDs only. You've got exactly 1 year and many months. Brilliant. Well, you know, this is a really, really good task. Nobody wanted us to fail, Taliban. Everybody was with us. We had proper funding. We had a really, really clearly defined scope. And we had 1 year, and we could self-organize. And that was the most effective use of my professional time ever. So, you could do anything. So we started. First of all, we had a kind of lozenge shape of work. We collect information, get more and more and more and more and more. Then you have to sort of down select, and then you have some stuff at the end. And then the FY comes. This is what we've come up with. So then stuff goes out to build, and it goes out to theatre. Right. During our collection phase, we found out some stuff to do with chemistry, and we found out that bees have got a really, really good sense of smell. And we actually had a strand where a squaddy would be walking down the road like this, holding a container of killer bees, and seeing what they did, because the bees would smell the explosives. Humans couldn't, our senses couldn't, dogs couldn't. And then you used to walk down here like a dog. It's getting twitchy. It just needs a pee, hold on.
You pick it up again, you carry on.
So we were looking at bees. I had an idea, which actually got through to the far end, but because we didn't have much time, we couldn't work through the civil service purchasing system. So I went onto eBay and I bought a spectrum analyzer and a signal generator and some other stuff, and I went out and digging holes, burying things. The milk bottle was kind of representative of an ID. And I buried that and that. And I had these sensors and stuff like this. And my neighbour, who had loads of families to work at Bletchley Park, he leant over the fence and said, "What are you doing, John?" So I'm trying to, oh God, this is secret, so I can't tell him. I'm looking for that milk bottle. Just lost it. Right, okay. I thought, oh, the car, it's easy to get rid of him. So I carried on. I was doing whoop, 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 and stuff, and there's lights going on and off, and it's raining, so I put bin bags on the stuff, and it's not going to come out again. And then one day it came across the fence. It was an old bloke, you could stick it across the fence like this. And again, across to where the milk bottle was. And you've got to turn this stick round, and he picked the milk bottle out. And he was walking towards me saying, "There's your fucking milk bottle." Well, when I was trying to find it, I mean, I know it's there. He was just trying to be helpful. Anyway, so that thing worked. So I bought £5 worth of kit off eBay, found the remote detection thing, 10, 15 metres, pretty good tactically. If you can find it in 4 seconds and it's 15 metres away, that's good, because then you can work out the rate of advance. And if there's something dodgy, you just go around it. You put a red flag on it, and someone who knows what they're doing comes around later and defuses it, determines if it is actually an ID. We had a whole bunch of things on it. It worked because we had huge latitude, which increased our variety, and we had a really, really simple goal. So we didn't spend a lot of time trying to figure out how do you manage it? Well, basically, what you want to do is have as many ideas as possible and have a massive mashup at some point and see what's best. Time and distance. It was really easy to do that experiment. So we worked in the UK, we dug a lot of holes there, we dug holes in Jordan, which we didn't fill in again. We dug holes in Afghanistan, we did fill those in again. And that was very, very effective use of time. We were incredibly agile, and we had someone all the time trying to figure out what it is we needed next and making sure it was there, so we didn't have to wait for anything. Anyhow, so I mean, it was innovative. It wasn't agile. I think it was before agile kind of made its way to this country. It was like 2010 or something. So there was stuff in common with agile thinking. But it wasn't actually done in a proper method. But I liked it because of the fact that we have really high latitude. You could do anything, go anywhere, buy anything, do any stuff you want to do. So, that's what the slide is. the more difficult one, and this is where we look to complexity, what we need to do now is to bring in problems of uncertainty, which is related to complexity. And highly complexity is, you probably have an increase in uncertainty as well. So, what I often do is I try to manipulate the worldview of people who are threats to the UK. So they get the wrong idea, and they either don't turn up, or they turn up and just do the wrong thing, and everything goes bleh. So I try to damp squib things. Okay, it's not a very satisfying end of a story, but it does mean that there's no holes in the ground, no dead people. So the two interesting degrees of freedom here. Let's have a look at these people to start off. You probably recognise this bloke. We think he's been kicking off in Amesbury now. Right, now I don't know if you know Wiltshire at all. Salisbury's there, Amesbury's there, I live there. So He's about 2 miles from my house, at home. So this is why I might get thin up fairly soon. He's fairly evil, but I can't say. What's the scale? I mean, you have Mother Teresa, and then you have. I don't know. Pretty evil, isn't it? Pretty evil. Three quarters of an evilness. This bloke, I don't know if you recognize him, James Jesus Angleton, who was the head of the CIA counterintelligence for a long time. His job, which is why he looks so knackered, was to try and figure out, do we have moles in the CIA? So he didn't sleep much. He had a really, really tough time. And actually, people thought that he lost the plots completely because he was convinced that there were really long-term, like 20, 30-year sleepers within the CIA. And I think he ended his career with a lot of people doubting him and no real resolution. And he had a tough life. It's very interesting the problem he had, though. And it does appear, some years after he retired, that he was right. At the time, he had no way of verifying what the situation was. This bloke here, you guys may be more in the sort of smirch rather than, no, spectre rather than smirch space. I've been older, so I didn't even smirch. For the great name. Counterintelligence is active, I'll get to that in some death camps and stuff like that. Well, don't do that anymore, do they? Why not? So, let's plot them on the genius scale. Here we go. Putin, yeah, he's pretty evil, isn't he? Pretty evil. But I don't think he's a genius. He has no long-term plan. There's no succession plan for Putin. What happens when he goes? Vacuum. Massive problem. There's already infighting in Kremlin because they know that he's getting on a bit. He's worth about $20 billion, by the way. Probably the richest person on earth. So for communism. So there's him. He's up there. Good and evil, not kind of rocket scientist stuff. Blofeld?
Well,
he's right up there. Possibly marginally eviler, and definitely a genius. Right, good bloke. Like that. Got a cat as well. I'm a cat person. Here's James Jesus Angleton. Mega brain, not at all evil. Now, the problem that this guy has is he's always being, he's having to take information all the time. What's the significance of stuff? How do you prioritize? Unless you select all of the information that's available, then you sit down, you go through it, and you put it in kind of an importance order. Because by the time you've done that, it's all out of date. So you've got a big problem there. And this bloke here was somewhere, imagine emotionally, between naivety and paranoia back here. Now this is, when you look at someone, you talk about knowledge or paranoia, you're talking about their behavior relative to something. He had no yardstick at all. So he can't tell, I mean, he knows he's on here somewhere. You don't really want to be either end, because you're not effectively paranoid, because you're seeing threats everywhere. If you're naive, you're not seeing the threats that are there. So you want to be kind of in the middle of him on. But wherever you are, you can't tell whether you should be moving left or right in order to reach the optimum. You don't know whether you're too naive or you're too paranoid. There's no way to figure out if you're in that place, should you move? And that's the problem he had. It's a really bad problem to have, systemically, but it's the same problem that you will have had, will have now, and will have in the future. When you're working with an open loop system, you can't tell if you should increase some factor or not. So, proof. Genuine picture, not taken by me. So, in terms of decision making, yes, it's necessarily more sufficient. You don't want to have information that is not true, clearly. People will be talking about intuition and deception today. I tend to think, trust your intuition. It's quite difficult to verify. We're also going to be talking about bias today. I think we've got people talking about cognitive bias, haven't you? And here's the thing I was mentioning earlier. Sometimes we're seduced into measuring what is easy to measure rather than what matters. So it's easy to measure simple things. But simple things only apply if you stick in the eyes and tell you guys. And all day. I'm It's really easy to measure things there, so you can verify stuff. Now what happens is the people that who don't understand your work is complex, they measure the simple things. And they try to control you because they're measuring simple things. So you have a simple project manager, dare I say, trying to control a very complex system, which is you and the problems that you're solving. Now the PM, he or she will not know about Ashby's law. But it may be worthwhile thinking about that, because you'll have to compensate for it. You'll have to try to measure things that matter, but they're going to resist variety because they are rewarded for simplification. It doesn't fit on the Gantt chart. It does not exist. That's the PM view, okay? You can't put knowledge, goodness, investment on the Gantt chart. Put money in your expected product, and that's exactly how they see things. And they should. You know, that's what they're paid for. But they're not equal to the task. So you need to be able to do their job for them as well as yours. Okay, no pressure then. Again, Google. What's going on? I don't know, it's something to do with opposable thumbs or something. Right, so we actually have a word for people that are worse than me, and that is raccoon. And they're people that are always saying, yeah, but what if you do such and such, or this cancel, we did that before, it didn't work, or well, I want to do this instead. What happens if you take it apart and put it back in the wrong order? Costs us money. So, I also found this. I don't think this was under experiment, but this is. I mean, that's innovation, isn't it? And I know what you're all thinking. What is that? Well, I assure you that it was there when the raccoon started. But if you don't look at that, you just see the raccoon. Okay. So, this that's basically been done. All I've done is give you a whole bunch of really difficult problems to think about. I don't provide any solutions at all, but that's life. So I'm going to finish with a really complicated Lego diagram now, which is germane to the problem. This is time across here. We're not there yet. This is you beforehand. This is a whole bunch of fascinating people all kind of milling around in kind of random tropic fashion. This is one of the bits of the conference. We're all collecting a bunch of people. This is not this session here, but the other sessions where we're dealing with a single subject. This is a bunch of people getting together, thinking about the same thing, okay? So they'll be interacting with each other on that single topic. What we move on to then, is after you've done a few of those, is that each time you've done it, you've come up, each of you, each of the blue blobs, more than four, has come up with some idea, developed something in concert with other people and in concert with the person having a session. Now what happens at the end, obviously, is there's an integration there, because that leads to this, leads to that, leads to that. And this blue block, if this one's the same as this one, by the time they get here, they know more. And that's like naturalistic decision-making, isn't it? You don't make all your decisions on Monday, because you know more on Tuesday. So the way information unfolds in something like this, is you come in, one topic, then several topics, then you think about the topics together. Really, the point about a keynote speech, and I'm glad I've finally got there, is what it's supposed to do is to bring things together. The idea of looking at individual topics, and when you go, you yourselves have integrated all of the ideas and made sense of them individually and forming a relationship between them. That is the emergent quality, and that is a naturalistic way of learning. So, where we are, you guys are here, up in one bit of Lego, and when you go out, you will have thought of the individual sessions you've attended, the relationship that other people have with each other on that topic, and the relationship between those topics as well. It's a crucial two-stage process. And that is how you address or mitigate complex problems, I think. So, and then you go to the outside world, and there's this fantastic thing that's happening when you solve things, and you manage to manipulate your project manager to give you realistic deadlines or proper funding. Or we'll go to visit the very process together. So I do believe that is pretty much it. So there's a couple of things embedded in this terrible sentence, two sentences. There's the stuff about complexity and the relationship between things, and this thing about uncertainty as well. Now I think that the concepts of Ashby's law, I think, is key to working in Agile systems. I also think that understanding how to manage uncertainty is key as well, and not be hamstrung by it. Because I know a lot of people, if there's any uncertainty, they can't progress. So what they do is they eliminate the uncertainty and then progress. But what they're doing is data retention. They're throwing away stuff. Because they don't know what something is, they throw it away. So when they're here, the thing still remains an unknown. It's going to be long felt here, but that's the thing that needs to deal with. So there you go, there's that sentence. Of course, what the outcome is this. Why is Agile important? Because the stuff that crosses our desks these days is complex. There are people really doing lots and lots of simple things, and they're fine, they're happy doing simple things, but we as a community are drawn towards the more complex, the challenging, harder to define, fuzzy-edged thing that's dynamic, as chaotic, it's got circularity in it, and it becomes a chaotic system, has emergent qualities. We are all, of course, complex problem solvers, and some of us complex problem makers at this point as well. So I think that it's been done. Yeah. Any questions?
Sure. John, if you could say a bit more about Ashby's law, which sounds really interesting, but can you give us some examples, a few more examples of, you know, this can control this, this can't control that?
Yeah, so I think probably the best real life one was the NHS one I gave you, where people in the urge to manage, they formalise and externalise things and make a set of rules. The more constraining they are, in fact, the more they limit people's ability to act, the more they think they're actually controlling the complex system. What they've done is they've mismatched what they're doing. They're constraining the actions of individuals and not the actual complex system. So they have an achieve by saying no mentality, which is really not what you need if you have something with lots of sort of eddy currents and so forth. People recognize principally from military blunders, that there's been a mismatch there as well. So certain people, I can't remember his name, there's an Israeli ex-brigadier who came up with systemic operational design. And his way of dealing with a complex operation where you've got a competitive engagement with someone else, so you've got two complex systems competing, probably within a third complex system, or with other proxy actors and so forth. Really, really complicated, transactionally incredibly intense, with tempo that goes up and down like a toilet seat. It's really, really difficult to predict. So what he said is, when you go in, you shouldn't go in with a whole list of rules that you then follow. What you need to do is to afford latitudes to people as the learning unfolds. So this comes back to the naturalistic learning thing, which is why I think it's something here for us to think about. The later you make a decision, the better it is, because you get all the best intelligence in during the meanwhile. And that means that you make a better decision, but what you can also do later on is figure out what it is you'll need to know next and start queuing intelligence resources to provide that verification. So that's a system that works over time. In basic control engineering, I think there's lots of examples. A steam engine can be controlled by, so it's got a couple of weights hanging around. The faster it goes, high that goes and cuts something off. It's a kind of first order servo mechanism. I think when we get to higher order systems and systems which are non-deterministic, I think you have just to think about, and the Americans call it overmatching. If they want to be able to get that arms round a problem rather than just keep perturbing it. I'll be honest, because I've been working in sort of the seen counterterrorism and military fields. Most of the examples I've had have been kind of had a military feel to them. But I don't want to confine it to that at all, because it applies from basic control systems through management, particularly in examples like the NHS, which is quite an extreme one. But I think that as you folk come across tasks and so forth, you need to understand the issue about variety. And as the Americans said, you need to get your arms around about having greater latitude. You need the space to be able to outmaneuver the thing you're trying to control. It's not necessarily competitive, but it is a controlling mechanism.
So I think a good example of that actually is the kids yesterday. Right, there are no constraints. They've got all the latitude in the world to do what they want, to build what they want, how they want it. But what's going to happen to them when they enter the workforce is they're going to hit a set of those rules where your job is this and that's what you do, and you've got a performance review linked to that. And you know, we've designed a system of work that works like this, and you're not allowed to change it. So they're in that space. So there is that aspect where they are. They have that naturalistic stuff that they can do.
There's a lot of stuff online about applications for Ashby's Law. And I didn't want to go into the thing too deeply, because actually his original tome is like 200 pages of solid mathematics. And I technically, I'm a mathematician, but I couldn't get past the first page. Man's a complete genius. So what everyone's had to do, unless you're actually a cyberneticist, is to abstract the thing and just treat it as a concept as simple as the diagram I put up, which of course doesn't do it justice by virtue of Ashby's Law. But I think it's best approached intuitively and look at something which is complex and think, do I have the latitude to be able to steer the thing or stop it going to failure mode? Other questions?
Okay. Thanks very much, John.